Members, good morning. We have formed the quorum and I'll call the meeting to order. This is the Health Services Panel. Since last meeting, the Secretary has issued two papers. The first one is by Mr. Ben Chen, discussion of the audit system, the effectiveness of the audit system of hospital authority. And the other paper is the support of cancer patients subcommittee. And the memo regarding the mammogram screening territory-wide. Mr. Ben Chen, please. Madam Chair, thank you. Last week, I wrote to you, Madam Chair, with an item to discuss the audit checking of the hospital authority. There is a lot of criticism of the hospital authority and for the GOPC. Why is it the waiting time is so long? Have they utilized their resources properly? Or are they making life difficult for the patients and make them wait for an awful long time? I've been chasing two departments for the reports, but I've drawn a blank so far. And I think that this internal audit report will be instrumental to the improvement of the hospital services in Hong Kong. I hope that we can have some discussion here. And I also hope that we can get access to the audit report in order to identify all the problems. So, Madam Chair, I hope that we can have these on the agenda for some discussion. Right, this will be conveyed to the authorities, and the clerk will liaise with the administration to see when this can be fitted in to the agenda. Thank you, Madam. Shall we invite the administration in, please? Dr. Elizabeth Kwok. Madam Chair, we've been following up on the mammography screening. The subcommittee work has been completed. We urge the administration to present the report to us for some discussion. Madam Chair, I hope that you would press the administration to come up with the report for our discussion, please. The Secretariat is aware of members' concern, and this will be taken up. There are no items suggested by the administration for the next meeting so far. I will work it out with the administration. All right, then let's get down to today's agenda proper. There are four items for discussion today. I'll be strict with the time. Item one is the development of primary health care and setting up of DHC Express. Professor Chen, please. Madam Chair, we're here to discuss with members the development of primary health care and the DHC Express. In order to reverse the treatment-oriented phenomenon in Hong Kong, we are planning to set up the district health centers in Hong Kong. The first one was set up in Kwai Cheng, which came about in September 2019. We will be extending the DHCs to the 18 districts in Hong Kong. We hope that within this term of administration, the six will be designated Sam Shui Po, Wong Tai Sin, Chun Wan, Yuen Long, Tuen Mun, and the Southern District. will be covered. In December last year, for Cemetery Pole and Wong Tai Sin, tender has gone out. We anticipate that in the second half of this year, the contractor will be awarded. It would take time to prepare for the DHCs in order to meet the needs of the public in the remaining 11 districts through invitation of interest. We will be setting up DHC expresses to provide consultation and assessment services for chronic diseases. For the non-recurring expenditure, it's going to be $600 million. We hope that the DHC expresses will be transitioning to DHCs. On the 1st of January, a consultation has been conducted covering the scope, the target recipients, and so on. We've been collecting views. We will continue to liaise closely with the stakeholders. And after consulting the steering committee on primary care, we will be coming up with the detailed plan. In Q3 2020, we will be inviting interests from the NGOs, and we will urge members to air their views in this regard. Thank you. Thank you very much, Secretary. At the Subcommittee on Cancer Patients, we have endorsed a motion that for the district health centers going forward, support services should also be made available for the cancer patients. Would this be considered, Secretary? I hope that you would give these some considerations. There are four members who have raised their hands to speak. Ms. Alice Mack, Su Ka-chun, Dr. Fernanda Zheng, and Mr. Ray Chen. Ms. Alice Mack. Madam Chair, we welcome these district health centers. We hope that more services can be covered in terms of preventative care and the identification of patients as early as possible. I hope that there will be more publicity and promotion. People don't have the focused idea about the DHCs. They thought that there would be treatments at these DHCs. I hope that you will promote the function of the DHCs in Hong Kong. Otherwise, people will feel disappointed and they think that it's not worth their time and that they can't be bothered turning up at these DHCs. And you can't achieve the purpose that you set out to achieve. Second, there should be a broader range of screening of diseases. And the stroke patients are getting younger and younger. There should be screening. Like the devices that can detect potential stroke patients and osteoporosis. I've attended a community women organization. Many women are not aware of osteoporosis until they fall and hurt themselves. They never thought about any preventative exercises and so on in order to guard against osteoporosis. Now, for chronic diseases like these, the DHC can organize talks and workshops and screening and so on for the potential patients. Professor, thanks very much, Ms. Alice Mack. We agree that the services of the DHC and the role of the DHC are there for prevention for the primary, secondary, and tertiary care. This is a novel idea at the moment. As I said, a lot of emphasis is put on treatment at the expense of prevention, and people are not sufficiently familiar with the new system. And there is indeed to ramp up the publicity and promotion. Since its inception in September, the DHC operator has been doing a lot of promotion, but due to the viral epidemic, many of the services have been scaled back, and this certainly took a toll on the early operation of the DHC. Also, we need to resort to technology on a wider scale. Of course, if we can achieve face-to-face interaction, it would be a good idea, but given the viral epidemic, we simply cannot do it. And the operator has indeed started a lot of work that doesn't require face-to-face interaction. As to the screening of different diseases, at the present moment, we are confined to certain chronic diseases that are stated in the tender contract. For primary healthcare, we seek to make it broader, like women's health, osteoporosis, and other women-specific diseases. In our consultation, we get to learn that these are areas that people would very much to see included.
So we will focus our efforts more on these areas. For example, in terms of women's health, we will step up our work. And in Kaohsiung area, ethnic minority is also one of our concern, and we will also enhance our services for them. So for the operators, they are now trying to step up their work. And we have also started some plans for women's health. The time is up, so maybe the supplements can wait. I would like to ask members if you want to speak, other than those who have already raised their hands, because I have to count the time. We should end this item by 11:25. If not, I'll draw a line here. Mr. Su Ka-chan. Thank you, Madam Chair. Now, for DHC Express, I would like to ask the Secretary about a figure. Well, I know sometimes if you want to build something good, you have to wait for quite a long time. So DHC Express is an example. Now it started to operate since last September, and in the first month, it only served 2,000 plus people, but the target figure should be 4,000. That's September last year. That's before the onset of the epidemic. So can you give us the figures of the following months, that is from October onwards? For the Kaohsiung DHC Express, do you have the figures for us? And after January, there was the outbreak of the epidemic. So have the figures changed? I hope that close monitoring can be made. And another question. In the paper, paragraph 7, you talked about Sham Shui Po and Wong Tai Sin DHC Express, and in December, you called for tender. So what's the progress of the tendering exercise? Now, when it comes to tendering, last time for the Kaohsiung DHC Express, the tendering exercise was criticized as not transparent enough. And maybe the Secretary didn't look at it carefully because you were one of the honorable patrons of the applicants. So Sham Shui Po and Wong Tai Sin, had this problem been resolved? And also now we have the epidemic, and you are going to build 6 more DHC Expresses. Have the plans been delayed? And can you tell us now that there will definitely be postponement? Secretary, 1 minute. For the figures, Dr. Choi will be giving them to you. As for the tendering exercise, because of the epidemic, now the timetable has been extended a bit. We are now giving more time to the applicants. As for our overall plan, we do not plan to delay it. We will catch up with the time lost. Dr. Choi, with regard to attendance, there has been progress. Well, in September, there were registrations, and in October, over 1,000, and in December, it's increased to 2,700. So with the development of the expresses and centers, we expect that there will be improvements, and we will step up our promotion. We hope that we can serve more people. Can you give us the figures in writing later? Yes, I'll do that. Dr. Ling Lin Wong. In paragraph 6 of the paper, the government says other than Kwai Ching, appropriate sites have been reserved for DHCs in the remaining 17 districts. Can you give me the locations? Maybe you can provide us a list in writing. Thank you for your question. When we try to identify sites, it actually was quite difficult. This is just an initial plan. We have to talk to the districts, and for some sites, they may have to be used for several purposes. Permanent Secretary. As for the 17 districts, that is other than Kwai Ching, and from Wong Tai Shin and Sham Shui Po, we have already called for tender. We have consulted the other district councils, and most of them support our choice of sites. So can you give us a list? Now, when we earmark sites, we need to follow certain procedures. Now, there must be internal discussions, and we may have to reprovision some of the facilities at a site. We hope that within the term of this government, we will be able to talk to all the DCs about the choice of sites. So you should already have a list of the 17 locations, but you haven't completed the consultation process. Well, for some sites, we haven't really decided yet because other works may be included. So I cannot tell you definitely the list at this moment. Well, for some sites, they may involve other government departments and other users. Do you have a timetable? That is, when will you go to which district councils, etc.? Now, we don't have the locations, we don't have a timetable, so we don't know what's happening. You just tell us that you have earmarked some sites, and then we don't know when this will be completed. Secretary, some of the sites have been decided on, right? Yes, for some locations, we are quite sure. And later on, we can give you the relevant information. Well, for this term of the government, we will try our best to make sure that these sites are available, because now we still have to go through some internal procedures. We have started the site identification work, but at this moment, we do not have a complete list of all the locations. But we promise you that within this term of government, we will make sure that this size are okay. But this is something for the long run. Now, for 7 districts, there will be DHCs, and for the remaining districts, there will be DHC Express. And we will invite NGOs to operate such DHC Expresses. So for these, the locations may not be, the identification of locations may not be that difficult. But for DHC, we need more long-term sites. and we may need government land. So once we are more clear, we will definitely report to you. I'm not satisfied with your answer. We really need a blueprint. And now you are doing this in a piecemeal manner, and you just tell us the scheme bit by bit. So how long will this last? 10 years, 20 years? Well, Dr. Wong, the secretary said that there will be a supplement later on in writing, and we will also be discussing this in the future meetings. Now, for DHC, is it something good? We support primary healthcare services. However, during the epidemic, the DHC has been suspended service for a period of time. I'm very surprised. Now, because it's for health prevention, for education, for dissemination of information, and you should teach people what to do during the epidemic. And if there is onset of symptoms, what should people do? The public is very concerned about this, in particular in grassroots areas. A lot of people, in particular the elderly, will need to know it. And for secondary prevention, you also need to do something more, because if there are symptoms on certain people, they may need to be to be referred to certain healthcare services. However, during the epidemic, the DHC suspended service for a period of time, and now you're only providing limited service, and you have to make an appointment to get service. The secretary said this is part of the healthcare system, so how can it be closed during an epidemic? Thank you, Professor Cheng. Well, it's like what you said just now. This is part of the healthcare system. It's not something that we can do away with. So when it comes to prevention, it doesn't mean that we can only do it during good time. Now is the epidemic period. We should be more careful. But for people going to such centers, most of them are elderly. So we are very concerned about social distancing. So for the services, yes, we suspended them for some time, but staff still went to work. And they were still doing work on chronic disease prevention, and they continue their services through electronic means and telephones. And for the epidemic, before Hong Kong had its first confirmed case, the center has already stepped up its work trying to educate people. But can you at least maintain the service provided by the center during the epidemic? Well, now we are providing limited service. People have to call a hotline, and then they will make an appointment to come in. So because we don't want to see a cluster of people at the centers. And also for health assessments, etc., people can make booking and they can still come to our center for services. I think this is regretful. I think the center should be more proactive, because they are in this neighborhood where a lot of people live, and the elders can visit them. Some elders don't even know how to call these centers. So if they pass by the center, they can just go in and get information. So even though you are now opening in a limited manner, you should still provide this kind of service. You can control the people flow, and then you should open the services to all. Yes, other than providing hotline service, we also have social platforms, and we are also cooperating with PTAs. For example, we will teach them how to maintain personal hygiene when you go to school, and emotionally how you should cope with the epidemic, and how can parents help their children, etc. So during the epidemic period, we have been trying to educate people. And the primary healthcare office has been monitoring the work. I totally agree with you. During the epidemic, we should do more to help people understand epidemic prevention. And DHCs should be playing a bigger role at the district level. Yes, that's what you should do, because at this moment, a lot of elders may not be able to go to hospitals. So maybe you should open for at least half a day every day so as to serve them. Mr. Ray Chan, I want to ask about the Kwai Ching DHC and what has it been doing since January. And now I discovered that it has actually suspended service for a while. So what role has it been playing? Now the Wuhan pneumonia is becoming endemic. Professor Yun Kwok-yong wrote an article on it, and he said that in 10 years' time, SARS 3.0 will definitely appear. So for centers like this, we should be more forward-looking. And now you're planning to build 18 DHC Express, but I don't think I can see a paragraph on epidemic prevention. So if we are expecting more infectious diseases in the future, can the DHCs do more?
It can coordinate the supplies, face masks and so on. And in Taiwan, the central authorities will be coordinating the sale. If the government doesn't want to be involved, maybe the government can provide more information about the availability. And also home quarantine, the DHC can in some way help conduct spot checks. By the time we have the DHC expresses all over Hong Kong, we can do more of this. Secretary, can you add more services to the list for the DHCs? Professor, thanks very much, Mr. Chen, for the question. During the epidemic, indeed, the DHC can play more of a role in the district in the prevention of communicable diseases. The epidemic is still with us, and we cannot rule out further communicable diseases raging in future. So on this platform, we can consider certain services that can be added to boost the services. And we will give the approval in this regard. The scope is rather narrow at the moment, but we will deal with the situation, especially in these extraordinary times. Ms. Yan Chen, Madam Chair, because of the epidemic, the tender date is affected for two DHCs. How much longer will this be affected? I fully support primary care myself. I'd like to find out more other than what's provided in the paper, the allocation of resources. The DHCs are operated by contractors. The government should make a distinction about the different categories, how much will be devoted to health assessment, chronic and acute diseases, prevention, the support of self-care, and the support for the terminal ill cancer patients, and so on. How can you make sure that the contractors will be able to divide up the resources to cover all these different services. Would you specify a breakdown in this regard? Also, I noticed that the DHCs are providing services, like they cover three highs. You know what I mean by three highs. They also provide the rehabilitation services. Many doctors and many organizations told me that osteoporosis is very much a part of the problems for many people. And many elderly citizens are suffering from this very disease. Will you also give any instruction that they should, instead of in addition to the three highs, and they should add osteoporosis as well? Right, the list is getting longer, Professor. Thank you very much. The tender deadline was supposed to be in February. Now it's been extended to April. And we are going to extend the completion time. So we will telescope the time in order to achieve what we set out to achieve. Second, about the resources, I can defer to Dr. Choi. We do have a management committee which is monitoring the utilization of the resources. Dr. Choi, in the tender document, it is provided that they have to let us know about the number of people they serve, the chronic and acute diseases, and so on. The allied professionals have covered all these different areas, so we don't specify the amount of money that they will be devoted to each and every category, but they have to give us the projection, and there will be a proportion. Professor Joseph Lee, two things in the paper. The first one is the progress of the DHCs, and the second one is the creation of the DHC Express. You have 2.5 years in the term to cover all of these initiatives. You have only one single DHC in Kwai Chung. What about the other ones? The other ones are in the process of consultation. You haven't quite done the tendering exercise. Like in Samsuri Po, you're going to have 11 DHC expresses. We have no objection, but can you tell us whether you will be able to pull this off? For the DHC Express, it is similar in nature to the DHCs. Now, this $600 million is non-recurring expenditure. You will be working in collaboration with the NGOs. Within your term, or within the term of this administration, we do support primary health care, the prevention and screening. You have to make preparation for this to happen. You haven't quite done the DHCs. Now, you have the DHC Express now, and they will be run by the contractors. It was similar to how the DHC is being operated. Do you have any location, any siting, any contractors? I can't see this happening anytime soon. The policy address and talked about primary health care 2 years ago. Are you telling us with these initiatives that you have already done this? We may end up with just one single DHC and one single DHC Express. How can we monitor the situation without any timetable or any roadmap? The paper merely mentions the availability of resources, and in 2020 Q3, you will be consulting on the 11 DHC Express. I am bewildered. After reading the paper, you're only giving us the direction, but this is not a directional paper. You don't have the minute details in this regard. Professor? Right. Madam Chair, for the district health centers, before the end of this term of administration, we will be able to do 7. We have them up and running, We have one up and running already. There are two, which is being tendered, Cemetery Point Wong Tai Sin. The tendering exercise will come to an end in April. And for the four, for the other four, we will get on with tendering shortly after the these two. Before end of June 2020, this will be completed. The other thing is the Deep Sea Express. Consultation started in January, and about 80 people or so attended the consultation exercise. A lot of the NGOs expressed interest. In Q3 2020, when the budget is available, we will then proceed to solicit proposals from the contractors. They will arrange the venue themselves. It is somewhat different in the operation in terms of Deep Sea Express. We have a cross-departmental committee which will be vetting the proposals, and then they will be getting on with the provision of the services. This will be happening next year. Professor Lee, for the DHC and the DHC Express, what about speech therapists? This is not available, and there is a dire need for these in the community. There are not enough resources, speech therapists, to test, provide tests for the elderly. Professor, yes, we do provide these kind of services. Dr. Choi, yes, this is provided for the post-stroke patients. The speech therapists are not there full time, but we do have the network. But it's not a comprehensive set of services, is it? Will this apply across the board for the DHC? Well, this is available for the stroke patients. After I drawn the line, there are two more members. Dr. Helena Wong, for the second time. There are four items on the agenda for today, and I'm afraid I find it difficult to fit members in for the second round. Dr. Kwokaki and Dr. Pierre Chen, right, please, 1 minute, maximize the time. You're going to have 2 minutes between you. Dr. Kwokaki, it's not hard to spend $280 billion to create the 18 centers. But the thing is, the center is on the 30th floor of a commercial block, and it would be hard for the senior citizens to get access to. It is really disastrous. Well, in Qingyi, we heard that an MCH will be built there. We asked the government to create another floor for the DHC. The bureau hasn't really consider that. The patients are running short of medicine or face masks and so on. That they do the consultation for the trauma cases and so on. You are spending so much money, it's not hard for you to spend the money, but do you have any ways to conduct assessment? It's no good just to chalk up the number. Can you evaluate how much effect you have achieved? Have you consulted the residents about their needs? You can spend millions and billions of dollars, but can you evaluate the effectiveness? Secretary, indeed, in the process of tendering, it is open, fair, and just. We have 2,600 registered membership, and well over 10,000 or 11,000 people have been served. We have asked the CUHK, the public health institution, to conduct a more comprehensive evaluation. Work has already started. As Dr. Kwok said, it's not simply a question of a number or number of trips people make to the center. It's a question of the effectiveness of the centers and also the contribution that they're making. Dr. Pierre Chen. Well, Madam Chair, it would take time for us to assess the evaluation, evaluate the results. That the DHC is there without doctors, and you simply cannot really get it off the ground. Now, during the critical time in Hong Kong, the center shut its door, and we are concerned about people running out of face masks. We were worried about people not being able to hand in their specimen. But this center is shut at this critical time. This is a time we should rally together, and the DHC is not playing its role. For private doctors, you're leaving them to their own devices, and you're giving them the vials to collect the specimen, but the anti-epidemic fund has left them out of the loop. You haven't considered the GPs and also the dentists in the private practice. So this primary healthcare is wholly regrettable.
Secretary. Yes, thank you for your views. Just now, I already answered this question once. Now we are in the epidemic. So when it comes to services, we also need to keep social distancing, but they have never stopped their work. We are running the risk of epidemics, so we've asked the operator to give us a plan. That is how it can make the DHC work more during such difficult times. But it has been playing its role in terms of fighting the epidemic. Well, maybe it's not that they are helping in monitoring the epidemic, but they have been helping students, parents, emotion management, epidemic prevention, and they are teaching people how to maintain personal hygiene, etc. And they already started this work in January. Well, during a certain period of time, they didn't provide face-to-face service, but all the staff still went to work, and they continued to provide their services. And also, on the internet, our doctors have been playing their roles. Well, actually, and DHCs have been coordinating in terms of patient referrals. And if more assessments can be made, I'm sure our services can be enhanced. Well, we can understand that members have high expectations of DHCs. Now let's move on to another agenda item. Item 4, the control and prevention of COVID-19 and Hong Kong's relevant measures.
Hello, 欢迎各位,
I would like to welcome the government representatives. Secretary, can you take us through the paper, please? Well, we've read the same paper many times. We do not need an introduction from the Secretary. Secretary, can you do it briefly in 3 minutes? Well, we're all very familiar with this. It's the same thing every time. Secretary, can you give us a succinct introduction of the paper? The clerk said that she has seen your raised hands. Yes, I'll try my best. On the 10th, 30th of January and the 11th of March, we reported to the HS panel, and on the 19th of February, also provided a paper to the LegCo, and that's about Hong Kong's measures for preventing and controlling COVID-19. And now there have been some new progresses. So I would like to take this opportunity to update members on this. In the past week, the coronavirus epidemic has been spreading to over 160 countries, and many countries are experiencing major outbreaks. So on the 11th of March, WHO announced that the epidemic is now become a pandemic, and it has spread swiftly to many countries. And now for Hong Kong, our imported cases have risen. Over 90% of our cases are now imported. So these patients may have traveled during the incubation period, or they may have come into contact with infected people. So for our work, we are now focusing on the prevention of imported cases, and we are trying our best to stop community transmission. Now things are changing very rapidly. And on the 7th of March, we made an announcement, that is, we issue a red travel alert against all countries. But it is not applicable to the mainland, Macau and Taiwan. The government also calls on people to change their trips. Now, if these trips are not essential, they shouldn't leave Hong Kong. Different countries, there are different quarantine arrangements. So this will also affect our people's travels. And also, in accordance with the compulsory quarantine of persons arriving at Hong Kong from foreign places regulations, we have also implemented new measures. That is, for all people arriving in Hong Kong from other countries, they would be subject to a 14-day mandatory quarantine. We hope that with this measure, we can help curb the spread of the disease. And also, we need to keep our society operating. At the same time, we have to curb the spread of the epidemic. So we have to adopt some measures very stringently. For example, social distancing is very important. We should not hold gatherings where there will be a lot of people. We really need to keep social distancing, and we hope that the people will be patient during this period of time. You shouldn't have meal gatherings, and you shouldn't gather in crowds. Of course, you have to maintain good personal hygiene. Do not touch your eyes, your nose or mouth. Wash your hands frequently, and use hand sanitizers, etc. When you sneeze or cough, you have to use a tissue paper, and afterwards you have to wash your hands immediately. And when it comes to toilet flushing, it's also very important. You must cover the lid of the water closet. And also, environmental hygiene is also very important. You must ensure air ventilation, and every week you should use 1 to 99 diluted bleach to clean your home, and make sure that your pipes are well drained, and you have to pour water into your drainage pipes every week. We are here to answer members' questions. I'm sorry, I have to ask you to speak so fast. The Secretariat has made preparations. So we have two clerks here. They will be looking at members' hands on my left-hand side and right-hand side. Now there are two lists. Okay, first of all, let's have court. Well, there are two lists, one from the left and from the right. It's very troublesome. It's above called etc. I'll just read out the names of all the members who have raised their hands. Anyone else? Have I omitted anyone? Okay, this one will be placed before KK Kwok. Change the place, please. Okay, 3 minutes, everyone. Secretary, I know that you want to explain to us in details, but we just have limited times. So we will stick to the 3 minute rule very strictly. Elizabeth Kwok, as the Secretary said just now, we are now facing a pandemic. And every day we have thousands of people coming into Hong Kong. Other than overseas Hong Kong students, we also have travelers and Hong Kong residents returning. Today, now we still have a two-digit increase in confirmed case every day. So under such circumstances, would the government impose a ban on European and Western travelers so that nobody will enter Hong Kong, because we really need to focus our healthcare resources on Hong Kong people. And a lot of parents have called me. They have been asking questions about their children who are studying abroad. Now, if they return to Hong Kong, a lot of parents are worried. They think that they shouldn't move back home immediately because the accommodation may be small, so there may be cross-infection. Yu Swing and I have talked to a number of hotels. A dozen hotels think that they can provide such facilities. That is, maybe these returnees can stay in the hotels for 1 or 2 days first, and if there's no problem, then they will go home for home quarantine. This would be safer for the whole society. But the government hasn't responded to this. Now, can you answer these two questions? Total ban on foreign travelers and using hotels as preliminary quarantine places. In the past 2 weeks, most of our cases are imported, but most of them are Hong Kong people. For foreign travelers and Hong Kong people returning to Hong Kong, they are all subject to a mandatory quarantine of 14 days. But of course, we will continue to monitor the situation for. And we will also be monitoring the number of non-Hong Kong residents entering Hong Kong. We have reasons to believe that the number of this will decline significantly. And for quarantine facilities, now with the enforcement of CAP 299E, we will impose a 14-day home quarantine. But for those who return to Hong Kong, if they want to stay in hotels for the quarantine, or if their family members do not want to live with them at the moment, then either they can stay in hotels or their family members can move to hotels. Well, time's up. Pierre Chen. When it comes to epidemic prevention, there are a lot of loopholes in the government's measures. Well, the first line should be the border. You should try your best to minimize imported cases, but the government is not really doing much in this area. A lot of other countries are already closing their borders. So after entering Hong Kong, what do you do? Well, after several days, now you are thinking of using the North Lantau Hospital. So there are these loopholes, and in the quarantine centers, the people, they are playing cards, and some of them are hiding their whereabouts, etc. I asked this question many times. Well, for the health declaration system, if people violate it, and if people breach home quarantine, or if people cover up their travel history, how do you enforce the law? Which government will enforce the law? What's the hotline number? Can the CHP give us information on this? That is about home quarantine enforcement, etc. Well, my colleagues will supplement later. I do not agree with what Dr. Chan said. Now, when it comes to the flow of people and immigration, you said that we haven't done much. Well, I cannot agree to that. Now, in the initial stage, we already imposed a ban on Hubei residents.
Recently, on six occasions, we have implemented port control measures, like the quarantine measures. Will you defer to Dr. Wong, Secretary, please? Yes, I'd like to defer to Dr. Wong for the details. Thanks very much, Dr. Chan. Indeed, the number of home quarantine people is high. We do have the monitoring system. OGO is assisting us in the monitoring here. We understand that there will be spot checks. If we spot any irregularities, we would give verbal warnings. We would issue advisories in writing. Which department will be enforcing the law? What number to call to make a report? Dr. Wong, for the spot check at home, the police would do it. Any number to file a report? It's not the police that enforcing the law in other jurisdictions. It is the Department of Health. Please don't evade the question. Ms. Yan Chen. Thank you, Madam Chair. From the 22nd of January, since we had the first case, we managed to have a very good defense. Now we have a new wave of infection imported from other jurisdictions. We have people coming to Hong Kong as visitors or as homecoming people, and this is a ticking time bomb. There are loopholes there. When now you have the North Lantau Hospital for checking those with symptoms, there are many people who are roaming in our midst. On the 1st of March, we hit the 100th case on March 19, 2009, breaking through 200 within a mere 19 days. Now, for the duration of 19 days, we haven't seen any escalation of our measures. This is the whole world is on a war footing. Now, we are merely enhancing the random checking. Shouldn't we consider implementing work from home and also mandating people to wear face masks? We are on a war footing. There are many people who are escaping the system. There are experts who are telling us that there should be independent separate rooms for the returnees. It's only when they test negative that they should be released. Now, you're talking media about designating North Lantau Hospital for testing, that there are big loopholes there. The epidemic will be getting worse in the coming weeks, and some worries are expressed that some healthcare workers might be vulnerable. So will you make sure that there will be 100% quarantine, and we will deny entry to non-Hong Kong people? And I'd like to ask the hospital authority, for ICU beds, do we have less than 60? If there are more cases of patients requiring intubation, will the ICU beds be enough, or would they be overstretched? Secretary, for non-Hong Kong people, we will monitor the situation and deal with this accordingly. So our focus of attention is to tackle the returnees. Ms. Chen has got a point. We are concerned about the numbers. We do have different lines of defense. You mentioned the monitoring for those who exhibit symptoms. We will do our best to tackle them. For those who are symptom-free, the DH has extended the monitoring, the surveillance system. There is a need to further extend the surveillance. It all depends on the capability, the capacity of the lab. We will take this forward. Hospital authority, you've got no time now. All right, perhaps you might follow up later on. Dr. K.K. Kwok, Madam Chair. We find ourselves in this situation because the government refused to close the border in the first place. We're facing a second wave. We're not talking about those who are coming back from Europe and America. We are concerned about community outbreak. How soon are you going to close the border to deny entry to people from Europe, America, and the mainland of China? You said you need to consider this. Do you have a time? Do you have a time frame for you to make a decision? Secretary, Dr. Kwok, the CHP and the government are talking about which day, tomorrow or day after tomorrow or Monday, how soon are they going to have an answer to close the border? Well, over 40 jurisdictions in the world are discouraging travel. Closing the border would be the most responsible act. How soon are they going to make this happen? Secretary, we are scrutinizing the situation. Tomorrow? Day after tomorrow or Monday? You've been talking about this for a long time. The figures are decreasing. We are focusing our attention. I never said that we're not doing it, but would it be Monday? We will scrutinize the situation. This is a non-answer, Ms. Secretary. Will you name a time when you will take a decision? We will scrutinize the situation. Well, you have been forbidding us for 2 months. And this is the mess that we're finding ourselves in. There are many parents who are at the airport for many, many hours. From Sunday, you have 4 days to tackle the problem. AWE is not open. North Lantau Hospital is not open until today. And the returnees are facing high risk. The labs are handling 2,000, can handle 2,000 cases. We are only doing 1,000 or so cases. The labs are doing their utmost to get the job done. Will you give us the undertaking that for the returnees, you will be testing them all? Secretary, for the returnees coming back to Hong Kong, will you subject them to the test? We will try our best. There are many asymptomatic patients, Ms. Secretary. Will you maximize the quota? If I may have some time to address your question, we have ramped up the surveillance for those who are symptom-free. They're also covered. The DH is, we're running out of time. Are you going to maximize the capacity of 2,000? My third question, there are many people who hope that people can stay in the hotel, including this Disney Hotel. How soon are you going to do it? Hotel, Professor, if the members of the public would use hotels to do the quarantine. This is allowed under Cap 599E. There are regular people, there are quarantine people in the hotel. Why don't you designate some specific hotel for this purpose? I'm sure other members will pick up on this particular question as well. Mr. Wai Kwong, Madam Chair, in the face of the Wuhan virus, the government is not doing a good job. People are fending for themselves, and they're not relying on Carrie Lam. On the 7th of February, Carrie Lam said that the CSI will ramp up the production for the contractors. And they are talking about cancelling this 70,000 volume. Why are you taking the decision of cancelling these 70,000 extra face masks, Secretary? The department is reviewing the situation in the light of the situation. So has there been such a decision? They will continue to serve those who are in need. I've been very nice to you, Ms. Secretary. Carrie Lam said, promised 70,000 face masks for the contractors. And we heard that this is going to be stopped. Is it really the case? Would you give us a reply here? Did you consider halting the production of the extra 70,000 face masks for the contractors? So what is the decision now? All along, the government has been concerned about the frontline workers, in particular the cleaners. Now, even they are not working for the FHD, even if they are working as contract workers, they will get the supplies. As far as I know, they will continue the production in this regard. We will try to do a better job. So did Carrie Lam think about halting the production there? No, this is not the case. This is part of the entire review process. She promised the face masks in February. Now it is in March. So is she stealthily halting the production and distribution? No, this has been clarified, and they did discuss it, but they will make available the supplies nonetheless. Well, I hope that you will not get the wrong end of the stick. I don't think that there should be any misunderstanding. Secretary, the cleaners are working very hard and they are vulnerable, and we rely very much on them for cleanliness. You talked about the $1,000 allowance for them. How soon will this happen? The hardship allowance, how soon will this be available? Well, you should direct this to the HAB. We will get hold of the information because this is the portfolio of another bureau, but within the government, we will try to make available the support as soon as possible. Like the FHD, we have already started the disbursement. And as regards Mr. Kwong's question, we'll consult other departments. This is a collective decision. You cannot shirk the responsibility to other bureaus because this is a collective effort. Well, please confirm the time. Mr. Michael Tin. Secretary, banning everyone into Hong Kong from places other than Macau and Taiwan. I'm sure that everyone has the consensus that we should close the border there. You said that you would scrutinize the situation. I'm not what you are scrutinizing at. At the airport, we have 1,300 people coming back in this category, and 14 days would mount up to 20,000. Where are they? Where are they staying in hotels? Do you have so many quarantine places? So 1,300 each day returning to Hong Kong or coming to Hong Kong, there is a consensus that we should shut the the border to them. So what are you scrutinizing and why are you not taking the decision? Why don't you close the border? We are scrutinizing the risks and the infection in these places. Now, for these 1,300 people, it's not the case that we're not doing anything at all. For Hong Kong residents and non-local residents, they are put under 14-day quarantine. You said that there would be a 14-day quarantine. There are still 1,300 people coming in every single day. What are you scrutinizing? Now, this has come into effect on Thursday. Now, these 1,300 is the day before yesterday's figure. The 20-odd Schengen countries have already closed the border. There are still 1,300 people coming. That's the figure for day before yesterday. We don't have the figure now for today. But what are you scrutinizing if the number still remains high? You will close the border. But can you name a figure? How small, how big a number will you consider closing the border? Secretary, well, it doesn't have to fall to a certain level, but we have to scrutinize the entire situation. Secretary, well, why don't you let the secretary have the floor? Well, it's not the case we haven't done anything at all. For these 1,300 people, we do have a mandatory quarantine measures applied to them. Do you have any criteria? What number does it have to fall? What level do you have? Would the number have to fall before you wouldn't consider closing the border? We'll scrutinize the situation. Why is the secretary meeting us today?
I know this is not the secretary's decision, it's the CE's decision, but can you give us a better reason? Mr. Chen, I hope that you can understand this. Well, for our measures, for both Hong Kong people and non-Hong Kong people, when they come into Hong Kong, they are subject to a 14-day mandatory quarantine. Ray Chen? Well, we are not asking for a 14-day mandatory quarantine. We are asking that for non-Hong Kong people, they should be banned from entering Hong Kong at the moment. Taiwan is doing this. Australia is doing this. New Zealand is doing this. European Union countries are doing this. So they are closing their borders. Every member asked this question. That is, will the secretary do this and under what circumstances will you do this? But she's been evading our question. So if I continue to ask the same question, she will give me the same answer. I ask you a simpler question. Now, Wuhan pneumonia is prevalent. So how serious does the government think it is? If the scale is 0 to 10, what's the mark? Is it the most serious? Is it most serious? I can give you three choices: not serious, averagely serious, and very serious. Now, the government has implemented a number of measures, for example, closing public facilities, asking civil servants to work from home, but now things are resuming normal. So the public thinks that the epidemic is declining. So actually, this private sector will just follow the government's practices. So the government should take the lead to do something. You should still ask civil servants to work from home. Now, so the people do not get a clear message from the government. So how serious do you think the epidemic is? Well, the epidemic is serious. So not very serious. It is serious. Now, if we look at the local situation, we also have to assess other countries' situations. Well, Mr. Chen asked if we should refuse the entry of non-Hong Kong people. the SAR government, well, has been very strict when it comes to immigration. Well, you are not closing the border, so how strict can you be? Well, you have closed public services, but can you now take the lead to ask civil servants to work from home because the epidemic is still serious? Well, we have always said that maintaining social distance is very important, and this has to be enhanced. And we have been reviewing our measures. In the past few days, we have been looking at our confirmed cases and suspected cases. There has been a trend of increase. So we will continue to step up our measures. So for non-Hong Kong people coming into Hong Kong, if the number goes up, will you consider closing the border? Well, we have never ruled out the possibility of doing that. In January, we imposed a ban on Wuhan residents, so they were refused to enter Hong Kong. And we also did this to Korea. So we are ready to step up our measures anytime. So in the coming 10 days, do you have an estimate as to how many people will come into Hong Kong? Well, for the coming 2 weeks, we expect that a lot of overseas students will be coming back from the US and UK. Well, we will have to look at the number of flights when it comes to the actual number of people. Yes, I know it relies on the number of flights, but do you have an estimate? Well, we can look at the past figures. That is how many thousands of people would arrive in Hong Kong after the imposition of the 14-day quarantine. But we get information from the airport authority is about 10,000 per day, but the figures change every day. Sorry, Lee. Now the epidemic is very serious in both Hong Kong and the world, and there may always be a second wave or third wave of outbreak. Now, in the last 2 days, the number of confirmed cases has increased significantly, so we are very worried. The government should be better prepared. Now, of course, we do not want to see a community outbreak, but if this unfortunately happens, do you have enough measures to tackle it, in particular hospital facilities? Can they cope? Do you have an emergency plan? Now, if there is a big community outbreak, do we have enough beds? Where can the patients go? Have you talked to the private doctors about this? Do we have enough ICU beds? Do you have a whole picture? And I have another question about face masks. Now, we need epidemic prevention items like this. Well, we heard from the cleaners and security guards that you are not giving masks to them. And you told us just now that you are doing this. So, how about the inventory of masks? Can you tell us what you have been doing about face masks? As for our overall plan, yes, we do have it. Well, WHO already announced that it's a pandemic, so we already have a plan. It's not just for the healthcare departments. The whole government should be prepared. Just now, Ms. Dory Lee asked about our healthcare system. Now, do we have enough beds, medicine, or manpower, or PPE? You know, all along, we have been making preparations. Later on, maybe we can ask the hospital authority colleague to answer the question. As for the provision of masks, well, the logistics department is still trying to procure face masks globally, and they are for our healthcare staff. And for certain special groups of people, we would also be distributing masks to them. As for the general public, Well, as you may know, donations of masks have been given to the government, and the government have been distributing these masks to the needy. And also, there are NGOs distributing masks. So when it comes to supply, we are working on local manufacturing. The Correctional Services Department has been increasing its capacity of mask production, and such masks can help frontline workers. Galina Wong. Madam Chair, the Secretary cannot answer this question. That is, why are you so reluctant to close the border? Now, more than 100 countries have confirmed cases, and the mortality rate is high in some countries. And now you just issue a red outbound travel alert. You are just asking Hong Kong people not to travel to other countries. But how about people from other countries coming into Hong Kong? You still welcome them. So after entering, you just ask them to go under quarantine for 14 days, but you do not have enough quarantine centers for this foreign travelers and Hong Kong returnees. You are killing Hong Kong. And for home quarantines, it's totally useless. You ask people to wear an electronic wristband. Some say that they can't even turn it on. Some say that they do not get a password, and some just go out wearing it. But their family members are very worried. Now their daughters and sons are coming home. So what would happen to them? It's not that every one of them would have an independent bedroom or independent toilet. How can they keep a 6 feet social distance at home? This is not achievable. I think you should set up enough quarantine centers in a very short period of time. Otherwise, you should lease hotels for these returnees or overseas travelers. Otherwise, when they are scattered in the community, there will be a lot of problems. And you do not update your list of infected buildings every day. Sometimes you don't even know whether you are living in the same building with an infected person. And if you do not designate certain hotels to be quarantine centers, travelers will be very worried. They do not know whether they are staying in a hotel with infected people. And it's also very risky for hotel staff. So the Democratic Party suggests that you have a complete closure of the borders. So can you tell us why you are not doing this? And for home quarantines, you've been doing a very messy job. Well, for complete closure, what do you mean? Do you mean that Hong Kong people cannot come back? Hong Kong people can come back. Other people cannot come in. I can give you some figures. That is about our the people coming into Hong Kong every day. Well, 90% of them are Hong Kong residents. Yes, I've heard your views about non-Hong Kong people. We will step up our work in this regard. We have never ruled out the possibility of launching more stringent measures. Liu Kuo-lun, I have the following questions first. For anti-epidemic, how about manpower? It's not mentioned in the paper, but it's very important. Experts have said that, well, there will be a lot of Hong Kong people returning to Hong Kong. Well, maybe our final confirmed case number will be over 600. The government has not said in the paper about this. So how are the hospitals going to cope? If we have more over 600 confirmed cases, how can you cope? You have never mentioned this in the paper. And there is another thing that's very important. How about manpower? Oh, for the people who are coming back from abroad, there may be two types of people. Well, some of them may even be healthcare staff, but they have to be quarantined for 14 days after coming back to Hong Kong. And what if children come back? If they stay at home, their parents would also have to be quarantined for 14 days. Now we have a shortage of healthcare workers. Well, under different circumstances, some healthcare workers may have to be quarantined in the future. So how can you ensure there will be enough manpower? And there's also a shortage of beds. Well, you're saying that there will be new beds. Where do these beds come from? If we have 600 cases, what will happen to them? We do not have enough ICU beds. Well, we need negative pressure beds, but the number is not enough. If there are serious cases, how will you handle them? Well, in 2014, I was already at LegCo, and we talked about flu epidemic. At that time, we talked about making use of the Hong Kong Stadium. But today, I don't see such proposals like this. So how can you assure the people? And how about PPE? The new PPEs are very fragile. It can easily be torn. So what do you expect of the frontline workers? I don't see any concrete tactics from the government. If you don't stop now, then there's no time for answer. Well, don't interrupt me. So how can you assure the frontline healthcare workers? They need enough manpower. They need sufficient PPEs. And how can you prevent outbreaks in hospitals? I'll ask the HA colleague to answer the question. Well, thank you for your questions. Well, as for manpower, of course, we attach a lot of importance to it. Now, we are minimizing our non-emergency services. And for non-emergency surgeries, it's reduced by 60%, endoscopy 40%. But we have to do it because we have to put the manpower at the most needed places.
My colleagues are working very hard, but we do have the allowance as a form of recognition. For the ICU beds, we have 97. One patient is in the ICU, this COVID-19 patient. In other jurisdictions, the number can go up pretty rapidly. For the step-down wards, we have 400 beds, and they can be converted. We hope that this can be done in a week's time. The hospitals are very busy of late. There are many suspected cases that have been kept waiting for a long time, even at the Port Health. You might wish to supplement later. Mr. Charles Mok, Madam Chair, I hope that the Secretary would not just talk about scrutinizing the situation. She should be more specific. We are telling you that we should close the border. Non-Hong Kong residents should be denied entry into Hong Kong. I hope that you would get on with the scrutiny and get on with your work. In the past 2 days, we've heard a lot of news that people have to be kept waiting for about 20 hours. You're using the AWE and North Lantau Hospital, and people were shoulder to shoulder waiting for the turn. Why is it the case? Is it because of a lack of manpower? There will be more and more people returning to Hong Kong, and some will be complaining of being unwell, and they have to go to the quarantine centers. There is a civil servant who has also succumbed to COVID-19, and there are many civil servants' children who are coming back from the UK in particular, and that would be compounding the problem. Previously, civil servants work from home. Now things are back to normal, and they'll be out to lunch like normal. Under these circumstances, would you ask the chief executive to declare the policy of work from home? Secretary, thanks very much, Mr. Mok. At the airport, I've looked at the situation. Normally, after hopping off the plane to get the quarantine order and to check through the immigration, the process is smooth. It all depends on whether there are many flights that are bunched together. In that case, people will have to queue up. Now, for the waiting, it is a different situation. If someone is unwell, he has to go to the port health for an assessment. If he has to go to the hospital, he has to wait for ambulance. We have alleviated the situation. Just this morning, we have the hospital authority has opened a testing center at the AWE. They don't have to wait for 20 hours. No, they don't have to. They don't have to go to the A&E. They would be tested first. If they test positive, then they'll be sent to hospital. If they test negative, they'll be allowed home. What about work from home? Yes, we noticed that the people are not practicing enough social distancing, and we will review the situation and consider more stringent measures to ensure that social distancing will be practiced. Mr. Ben Chen? Madam Chair, thank you. People who've come to Hong Kong may be going home, they may be staying in hotels. When they are making the booking, the hotel would know that it is for quarantine purposes. And the hotel staff may not have the sense that people are coming here for quarantine, and they may not have the right gear and equipment. So will you notify the hotels about the kind of people who are staying at a hotel for quarantine purposes so that they will be getting themselves prepared? I defer to Dr. Wong Kai-hing regarding the hotel practice. They've issued guidelines to the hotels, in fact. Dr. Wong, thank you very much, Mr. Chen, for the question. Like the Secretary said, at the early stage of the epidemic, the CHP has issued different guidelines. For the hotel industry, we have indeed issued guidelines to them. I know you have guidelines to different sectors, but my question is, for those who come to Hong Kong and stay in hotel for quarantine, will you notify the hotel as such? Yes or no? Dr. Wong, the quarantine order is issued for the individuals, so you will not notify the hotels, would you? No, we don't do this. What about the hotel staff when they are cleaning up the rooms, and if they happen to clean the room of an occupier who's an infected person is likely to cause an infection. So it is a serious problem, isn't it? In our guidelines, we do have the infection control measures. But if they don't have the PPE, the protection gear, how can they guard against the infection? Dr. Wong, other than issuing the guidelines to the individuals, we also issue them to the hotels, and the staff members in the hotel would be made aware of the guidelines. So a set of guidelines would guard against the infections, so we don't have to do anything at all, just distribute the guidelines to the rest of the world, and things will be all right. So this is a very serious situation, Madam Chair. If they don't notify the hotels about the situation, if they get infected, will this be covered by the labor insurance? But time is up. You might wish to leave your question later. Ms. Alice Mack, Madam Chair, we are very concerned about the confirmed cases. Most of them are coming from outside of Hong Kong. Now, how can we make sure that these imported cases will be kept down? In Macau, they've said that non-Macau residents would be denied entry. Will you go so far as to what Macau has done? Also, we are talking about quarantine. We are concerned whether the wristband would be able to achieve the desired effect. And home quarantine, how can we make sure that people are not going out and about and roaming in our society? Unemployment rate is very high. Will you consider opening up some short-term posts? You hire people to do to ring these quarantine people up to make sure that they are not roaming in society. That way, you will create jobs. In the tourism sector, there are many people who are out of a job. Would you consider hiring these people on a part-time basis for them to call up the people subject to quarantine and to make home calls? Many people are concerned if their block of flats has anyone subject to quarantine, they would find out whether these people are observing the quarantine order, whether they're at home, and they would try to spot whether they have the lights on and so on. Professor, as Ms. Beck said, we will review the situation. We don't rule out any more drastic measures. We are concerned about the entry of non-Hong Kong residents, but well over 90% of the people coming in are Hong Kong residents. Even for the 10% or less than 10%, we will pay particular attention. For the mandatory home quarantine, how can we make sure that we can get the job done properly? This is statutory, and this carries a penalty, and we have to rely on people to be disciplined, and for the wristband, at the beginning there was a bit of a lag because of the sheer number of people involved. And according to OGO, they are paying particular attention to that, and they are monitoring the situation all along. As to how we can increase the number of people who are tasked to make the calls, the Department of Health has already stopped certain services, and the manpower would be devoted to this kind of work. And other than the DH, the HAD, and SWD, as well as the discipline services, have also been assisting in the inspection. We would keep an eye on the manpower. We do not rule out hiring more people, hiring more volunteers to do the job. I have Ms. Tanya Chen, Di Chu, Xu Ka Chun, Peng Xiuping, Jeremy Tam, Dr. Fernando Zhang, and Lo Wai Kwok. Anybody else? If not, I'm going to draw a line there. We have a dozen or so people here on the list. We have a motion to get out of the way. I'm going to cut your time by the 3rd minute. Ms. Tanya Chen, the Secretary must aware that we have double-digit increase every single day. You must be aware of the severity of the situation. Mr. Tin said that your top boss is not listening to the experts. Even Donald Trump is listening to the experts. We have double-digit surge, and a lot of measures are not there, like work from home. I mean, this policy has become non-existent. I'm not sure when you're going to be waking up the situation. She's always lagging behind, and I don't think we should be paying with our lives. Dr. Ho Pak Leung said that we are very concerned about healthcare workers, and the wristband, you have distributed 6,000 and only 2,000 have been activated. And you're asking people to practice quarantine on their own. The AWE, the Asia World Expo, is 100% owned by the airport authority. The government owns the airport authority 100%. Why do you have to leave it so late? The government doesn't have any foresight. The experts have contributed their views. What is the steering committee doing? You have the press conference every single day at 4:30. That's a more practical press conference. The government must be aware of the situation. You must know that the flights are bringing in thousands and thousands of people to Hong Kong, and many have arrived before we closed the border. Now, during the incubation period, despite your testing, people can still be carriers. How can the government make sure that everything will be okay? You talked about increasing the manpower. It seems as if you're only starting now, and it's too late for you to proceed like this. Secretary, we understand the seriousness of the situation. We do not rule out any more drastic measures. We are concerned that the members of the public are out and about more, and they're gathering more, and this is filling us with concerns. We will review the situation to see how we can implement the social distancing more rigorously. As regards to the AWE, just one word, Secretary.
If there's community outbreak, that's the end. Yes, we understand that. Eddie Chu, yesterday at the council meeting, a lot of members say that, well, you pandems would not have the guts to close the border to the Americans. So if you said that, please support Mr. Ray Chan's motion today. Well, Secretary, I know that you are thinking about closing the border, and in Taiwan, they have a policy. That is for people coming from abroad, they would not allow them to take public transport. They would send them to the places they want to go in specific vehicles. And for Hong Kong, so those coming in, you should put them in some centralized places, for example, hotels. I think in Hong Kong, there are certain premises which are holding special leases. So can you make use of such special leases? You can still pay them if you use their premises. And for the $1,000 that will be given to cleaners as subsidies, some chaos have been caused. Now, for frontline workers and for those who are working in the refuse collection points, not all of them are cleaners. Some of them are supervisors. Some of them are drivers. So if you just give $1,000 to the cleaners, you cannot boost the morale. You are just driving a wedge among them. And some people may even go on strike. So I hope you can suggest to your superiors, that is, when you disperse these $1,000 to the frontline workers, you should include the refuse collection points, supervisors, and drivers. Thank you for your question. As for transport, now, if people are asymptomatic, we do not have special arrangements for them. Now, for those who go to quarantine centers, of course, we would arrange transport for them. I understand that some people hope that the government would use hotels as quarantine centers. Earlier on, we did look at the locations of possible quarantine centers. Well, for hotels, their infection control measures may not be enough. How about drivers and supervisors? Time's up. Mr. Su Ka-chan, well, one of the secretary's soundbite today is, well, we will look at it every day. Just now, you answered Mr. Ray Chen about the five-point scale. Now, you are one of the principal officials. How do you feel about the government's handling of the epidemic? Well, give me a score on a five-point scale. Are you complacent? Well, you think the infection rates in Hong Kong is not high, the mortality rate is not high when it's compared to other countries, so you think you're already doing a good job? So I want to know your feeling. Just now, Edgy also asked about the masks for contract out cleaners. Well, they may have masks now, but drivers and supervisors and pest control team members may not have masks. So would you also provide masks to them? Are you still insisting on one mask a day? And how about private masks? I also asked this question last time. Now, if the cleaners use their own masks, that is, the masks are not provided by the government, the contractors may ban them from doing that. So I asked this question, but there was no answer. Now 10 days have elapsed. Can you give me an answer now? Thank you for your questions. Well, for this epidemic, it is serious, and we have to be well prepared, and we need to step up our measures from time to time in order to contain the disease. We need to prevent imported cases so that our community will not be infected. I understand that a lot of Hong Kong people's children are coming back. We have measures in place to prevent community transmission. So we are focusing our work on these two areas. As for cleaners and other staff, when it comes to the $1,000 allowance, we will try to disburse them as soon as possible. Only 30 seconds. So what's your feeling? And how about one mask per day? And how about the other staff members? Can they use their own masks? As for masks, well, if our supply of masks improves, we will try our best to distribute them to the most needy. We will continue to monitor the overall situation. Kun Xiuping. Next, Wu Chiwai. Many members have asked about community outbreak. Now, every day, how many virus tests can we do? Is it enough to cope with the influx of travelers and Hong Kong returnees? Well, sometimes people are asymptomatic and they can spread the virus in the community. What strategy does the government have to cope with this? If you do not test everyone coming into Hong Kong, and for home quarantine, people may face a lot of restrictions physically. Not many people have independent rooms for their children at home. And the government is still reluctant to use hotels as quarantine centers to help these families. Well, because if they do home quarantine at their present apartments, they may face a lot of difficulties. So I would like to ask you why you are still reluctant to use hotels to help the families who have to face home quarantines. Thank you for your questions first. Later on, I'll ask Dr. Wong to tell you about the daily number of tests. Of course, now we are all focusing on the returnees and the tests to them. At the general outpatient clinics, we have over 60 of them. And the emergency and accident departments, they have expanded their tests and services. And also now it is extended to private doctors. Dr. Wong, every day, the DH and the HA are conducting 2,000 tests. The number has been increasing. The DH has enhanced laboratory surveillance, but we have over 10,000 people coming into Hong Kong. I'm just talking about the airport, not including the land borders. Well, as for laboratory capacities, yes, of course, there are limitations. Well, the number of confirmed cases is now shooting up, and there are many probable cases. So we have to accord priorities to them. A lot of resources would have to be used, for example, laboratory resources. Now we have a pandemic. We have to be very careful. For people who are asymptomatic, we have to be very cautious. So what's the cost of a test? It's not about a test. It's not about a cost. It's about a tester and equipment and manpower. We are subject to a lot of limitations. So that's one thing very important. That is, we need to reserve capacity and resources for probable and confirmed cases. The SAR government has done a lot, but it doesn't mean that everything it does is good. There is still a big room for improvements. Members have pointed out many loopholes. You should pay attention to them. And my constituents are very concerned about one thing. Well, for the returnees, they are subject to a 14-day quarantine. The commercial and industry sector has many factories on the mainland, and since the Chinese New Year, these people have never returned to the mainland, but they have a lot of things to do. They have to pay their employees, but when they come back to Hong Kong, they have to be quarantined for 14 days. So for anti-epidemic product-related work and some other specific work, you have a quota of 2 persons, I think. But many factories are not doing this. So the responsible people would have to go back to the mainland to carry out their work. So can you relax your exemption a bit? Yes, we understand that there is such a need. Well, the Chief Secretary's office is responsible for such exemptions. So for the factories, well, that are manufacturing essential items, they enjoy certain exemption. And from the 17th of March onwards, the responsible people of these factories already allowed to go to China. As to whether there will be further adjustments, well, we are reviewing this every day. We are looking at the situations in different places, well, in overseas countries, on the mainland, and in Hong Kong. And we are now still adopting this exemption approach for this purpose. Of course, a public health risk assessment is also very important. Jeremy Tam, Fernando Zheng. The secretary says that she has to look at things every day. I don't know what she's looking at. This is a very clear graph. This is about daily new confirmed cases, thanks to Apple Daily. Well, for the red bar, it's imported cases. Blue and green, suspected cases and probable cases, they are local cases. So for the worst, for the first wave imported from the mainland, and then we have a local outbreak. And the latest situation is we have almost all the cases are imported. So you can see the red bars are getting taller and taller. And then the blue and green bars will grow again. This is about local cases. So do you have to continue to look at the situation? We will continue to have more imported cases, and then we will have a major community outbreak. And this would exceed the capacity of our healthcare sector. Well, the secretary says that for the people coming into Hong Kong, there are only 10% of them are non-Hong Kongers. But we are talking about more than 1,000 people. Let's not talk about the Hong Kong-Macau Bridge. I'm just talking about the airport. Okay, there are 600 non-mainland residents and non-Hong Kong people who came into Hong Kong yesterday. This is really worrying.
Well, they come in and they're put under home quarantine. But out of the 6,000 wristbands that you have distributed, only 2,000 can be activated. Home quarantine, you have family members and the home situation, home setting is crammed and there is a likelihood of community outbreak. Like Dr. Ho Pak Leung said, and we are on a war footing. The healthcare workers are facing tremendous risks and life is at risk. They're running out of ICU beds, they're running out of beds in the ICU, and this is hitting capacity. You're refusing, you're reluctant to close the border, and home quarantine is so lax, and you're not requisitioning the hotels and designating them as quarantine places. Hong Kong will be in for a major outbreak. So are you going to turn the situation around and tell your boss that life is really at stake? Thank you, Dr. Zheng. Now, indeed, we are waging a war here against the virus. I am saying that I'm scrutinizing the non-Hong Kong resident situation. We do not rule out any drastic measures. For Hong Kong people who are returning, we have to let them in. Over the past fortnight, on 6 or 7 occasions, we have stepped up the quarantine measures. There may be limitations at the beginning, but we will try our best to make improvement. Please work hard continuously. Mr. Xu Kafai is not here. Last speaker, Dr. Lo Wai Kwok. Thank you, Madam Chair. Since the outbreak of COVID-19, the response measures have yielded some effective results. Otherwise, there won't be so many Hong Kong people who are in Europe and North America who are scrambling to return to Hong Kong, and they are bringing pressure to Hong Kong. I think we have to face the situation. They are Hong Kong people. We cannot leave them to their own devices. There is a keen demand for quarantine facilities. We have the modular centers, Penis Bay, the JPC Center in Pat Heung, and also Lei Yu Mun Holiday Camp and Sai Kung Outdoor Recreation Center. The Lei Yu Mun one at first phase has already been commissioned, and they have got this done really post haste. For the other projects, how soon are we going to see this materialize? And this is of concern to us. Penis Bay covers a vast area, and this is 4 hectares of land. Mainly, it would involve the water and electricity supply and switch connection on the site. There will be 100 prefab construction units there that only take up a small portion of the land, and there is ample room for further development. The government said that they have planned to built on this piece of land, but I think we have to accelerate the process, and I hope that we should seize the opportunity. The other question was asked by other members, that is using hotel as some quarantine facilities. The problem is happening now. From the news, we learn that there are people being quarantined in hotels. Some are doing this in a very cautious manner, but not many of them are measuring up to requirements. The government cannot evade the issue. The government has to step in to make sure that everything is done right, everything is in order, and people in the vicinity will have their mind at ease. And they don't have to be worried about any health risks arising from the quarantine. You don't have very much time, Secretary, 10 seconds. Now, for the quarantine facilities, we have 1,200 places at the moment, and we are getting on with some additional facilities that will provide us with some additional 1,800 places, and they are coming on stream gradually. We will review the quantity of the quarantine units, and also the risk situation. There are two more members, and I think we have to move on after these two members. Mr. Prince Yuping, Madam Chair, thank you. I've been shuttling between the two places. I was having the transport panel meeting next door. We are very concerned about the epidemic. We are concerned about an outbreak in Hong Kong. If you learn, if you read the newspaper, in Lan Kwai Fong, in the fitness centers, there are cases. We're also concerned that cases may arise in Lechko, and there may be confirmed cases here. But be that as it may, we see the outbreak in other jurisdictions, and many Hong Kong people are returning to Hong Kong en masse. The number is significant. When they come back to Hong Kong, there is a risk of transmission. I think we have to do something to minimize the risk. The Secretary said, we should make sure that there will be social distancing. And for the wristband, I learned that many of them are roaming around in their wristband. And my question is, how can you make sure that these suspected cases were subject to home quarantine will be quarantined in a proper way? If we have an outbreak, now you said you would scrutinize the situation, Secretary, you mentioned the manpower and the hospital. If we have a community outbreak, would you, ahead of this happening, devise or formulate policies to guard against this? And the government has achieved good results in your battle against the virus. But it would be hard for us to get to grips with what's going to happen next. And the measures will be important. The government should make available all these measures to us, not just telling us to wash our hands and to practice hand hygiene and so on. You haven't got any time to respond. I think your question will be duly recorded. Mr. Jeremy Tam, last speaker. Yes, I was attending another meeting next door. I'm not sure whether this question has been put. The quarantine centers, how many people can they accommodate altogether? We have 1,200 units, and we do have development works going on to increase the number. Some will not be available until July, and that will provide an additional 1,800. Right, 1,800 up to July. Altogether 1,800? No, additional 1,800. Right, for the 1,200, how many people are occupying them? 600 or so, right, 600 or so are occupying them. I can see that you will be bringing people back from Wuhan. When they come back, we are faced with the second wave of infection. Many people are returning, are scrambling to come back to Hong Kong from overseas jurisdictions. And during the second wave, the risk of community outbreak and transmission would be high. Now, with these 1,200, you have 600 remaining, of course. There are some who will be discharged, and there will be people moving in the meantime. Do you consider, did you think that the 1,200 units will be sufficient to accommodate those coming back from Wuhan, or would you delay their return? Professor, the first batch of Wuhan returnees, they've left the quarantine centers day before yesterday. We need time to do the cleansing and disinfection. Our plan is that we should be able to accommodate these returnees from Wuhan. It won't be until the 20th or thereabout before the arrangement would be necessary. Mr. Tam has a point there. I think we have to reserve enough places at the quarantine centers for the high-risk people. For those who are confirmed, of course, they will be admitted to hospital. For the close contacts of the confirmed cases, they have to be sent to the quarantine centers. I've got a few seconds. Very quickly, we have 20 confirmed cases yesterday and another 20 today. At this rate, the trend is going up, and the close contacts, the number will also go up. So now you anticipate that the Wuhan returnees will be coming back on the 20th, and I think you have to reserve sufficient space there. Yes, we will review this on a regular basis. Xu Ka-fai, who indicated to speak, he's already come back. And James To, who just come in, would also like to have the floor. He said he needs 1 minute. That's good. Thereafter, we will deal with the motions. And we also have another item on the 10-year hospital plan and the creation of a post there. I'm going to extend the meeting a little bit. Mr. Xu Kafai, Madam Chair, we have been monitoring the development of the epidemic before the outbreaks in Europe and America. We already have seen the results of our battle against the epidemic. My grateful thanks to the DH and the healthcare workers. And nobody can guarantee that we can bring it down to zero. But I think we have to make sure that the risk is minimized. We have closed the boundary control points at Wong Kong and so on. That would stop the source of the infection. Now, if we have to close the border, people it would start panic, and we saw panic buying of toilet rolls. I think we have to make sure that the supplies will be able to be transported into Hong Kong to assuage people's concerns. Now, had it not been for the second wave arising from Europe and America, we managed to achieve pretty good results regarding the control of the infection from the mainland. We had about a dozen or so cases. Many of them are imported into Hong Kong. Had it not been for the Europe and European and American outbreak, we could have kept the situation under control. There are many students who Hong Kong students, Hong Kong people who are studying overseas, when they come back to Hong Kong, we have to let them in. And I'm sure that we're going to see a third wave. For the returnees, I hope that the Bureau will exercise due caution to make sure that they're not really out and about, and we have to do something about their family members. They are living under the same roof, and this is very much a challenge. This challenge is going to be even more tremendous than the previous challenges.
And
a second point. Well, some Hong Kong businessmen have factories on the mainland. Well, in the past 2 months, we had the epidemic, and now the factories resume working on the mainland, but this businessman cannot operate, because if they go to the mainland, when they come back, they would have to be quarantined for 14 days. So what can be done? So for these people who own factories on the mainland, can you allow some of them to go back to the mainland? Yes, for safety's sake, when they come back, can you conduct a quick test on them so as to give people confidence? I'm not saying that they should be quarantined for 14 days. Okay, the secretary has heard you. Mr. James Toh? Well, just now many members say that for non-Hong Kong people, they shouldn't be allowed to come into Hong Kong. That includes the mainland people. So if you make such a decision, do you need to ask the central authorities? Well, this epidemic is very urgent right now, and for big decisions and important decisions, we made it together at the steering committee, which is chaired by the CE. So all the bureaus and departments will discuss and agree. I am saying if you need to ask the central authorities. So do you mean that the steering committee can decide on such things? Well, for the CE's office, if there is a need to communicate with the mainland, this will happen. But for this particular question, if there is a need, I think the CE office can make a decision. So we've wrapped up the discussion of this item. Now we will have to handle the motions. I got two here. One is moved by Mr. Ray Chan. And Mr. Chan Han-pan and Alex Mack made an amendment to Helena Wong's motion, and there's another motion by Helena Wong. So do we handle these motions? Because they are all related to today's topic. Can I say one thing? I have a question. Well, because my motion is amended by Chan Han-pan, Alex Mack, and Ms. Kwok. They say that with the present measures, and then they cross it out. I don't know what they mean. Chan Han-pan, as for the present measures, well, for drivers who are transporting goods for us, and if we look at Mr. Ray Chan's motion, these drivers will be banned from coming into Hong Kong. The Hong Kong people will starve to death. So I just want to ratify it. Because Mr. Chan's motion may change a lot of things. Okay, thank you for your clarification. So are we going to handle these motions? Can you raise your hands? Can we ring the bell? Because some are in the other room. I'm just asking you if we are going to handle these motions. Okay, if there's no objection, then we will handle these motions. The first one is the motion moved by Mr. Chan, Ray Chan, or the amended motion, which is amended by Chan Han-pan and Alex Mack. Let's ring the bell for 5 minutes.
15分鐘. Hi.
I have some question, Madam Chair. Well, just now you say that we should discuss the 10-year hospital development plan. Is about 4 construction projects and the addition of 1 supernumerary post. Do we have enough time to talk about that? I mean, do we have enough time to discuss that? Well, this meeting originally should end at 1:15. I've extended it to 1:30 because I want to talk about that particular item. If we cannot finish the discussion of that item, it doesn't matter. We can carry on at the next meeting. Mr. Chan Han-pan, can you read out your amended motion? Chairman, I amend Mr. Ray Chan's motion. This panel asks that the government scrutinize as soon as possible the present measures. That is, all non-Hong Kong residents should be banned from entering Hong Kong at all BCPs. And for those who have entered Hong Kong, 100 of them must be given coronavirus tests. We're doing this in order to allay the risk of imported cases. Madam Chair, I have questions. I want to make a technical amendment. They should use the Chinese term 2019冠狀病毒病. For members who are not members of this panel, please do not vote. Now, let's vote on the amended motion moved by Chan Han-pan and Alice Mack. For those who support the motion, please raise their hands. Unanimous. Do you want to have your names recorded? Okay, it's unanimous. Nobody asked for recording their names. Okay, next we will handle Dr. Helena Wong's motion, but there is also an amendment. It's moved by Alex Mack and Chan Han-pan. Let's ask Mr. Chan Han-pan to read out his amendment. Do we need to ring the voting bell again? No? Okay, Mr. Chan. Well, I've just deleted some surplus words. Well, this panel urges the government to tighten anti-epidemic measures, in that is to immediately ban non-Hong Kong residents from entering Hong Kong through all PCBs, and all those who have entered should be tested for coronavirus. So this is an amended motion moved by Chan Han-pan and Alice Mack. For those who support the motion, please raise their hands. It's unanimous. I announce that these two amended motions are carried. Next, let's move on to another agenda item. Would like to thank the government representatives for attending today's meeting. The next item is four projects under 10-year hospital development plan and proposed creation of one supernumerary post of government architect in the Architectural Services Department. We'd like to welcome all the government representatives. First of all, Dr. Choi, can you take us through the paper, please? Thank you. Well, for this paper, It is about four projects under 10-year hospital development plan and the creation of one supernumerary post of a government architect. We want member support. Well, I would like to give you some salient points. Well, for the HDB projects, the first one is the main works, superstructure refurbishment for the expansion of United Christian Hospital, and second, demolition, site formation, and foundation works for the redevelopment of Brentham Hospital. Third, the construction of a community health center, cum social welfare facilities, and Parkwall Road North District. As for this structure, we will have to demolish an old two-story school building, and a new complex will be built. There will be new facilities, for example, daycare center for the elderly, etc. And also, we will be reprovisioning facilities from other places, that is, student health center, elderly health center, and an outreach social service team's office, and a student service team's office. Fourth, the construction of a hospital authority supporting service center. This is a new building, and there will be a laundrette, and there will also be a food manufacturing unit. Another unit will be that of a computer center, and also there will be a storage for linens and PPEs. And also, there will be a creation of one supernumerary post. Now, because we will be having this 10-year hospital development plan, and we will need more manpower, and also other additional work. So we need a new supernumerary post to take care of all this. So this will be a government architect. We hope members can support us. And then this proposal would be submitted to ESC and then FC.
Thank you, Under Secretary. If members have any direct or indirect pecuniary interest, please make the declaration. I will have three members on the list. Anybody else? Four? 4 minutes each. Dr. Pierre Chen, thank you. I must support all the projects under the 10-year hospital development plan. Every time we talk about the hospitals, we tend to rush them through very quickly. As I said, I will support the projects, but I'd like to make a point here. If we proceed like this, it would be difficult for us to play the monitoring role. Every time we have a preview of these hospital development projects, we tend to rush them through without asking questions. We tend to see overspends. We tend to see delays. The hospitals and development don't experience as much as many problems as other projects in this category. Rottenchi Hospital, for instance, there was a market access where we like to build an escalator and a lift. It was proposed by the last term administration. But that delay caused us a long time. I mean, it took us more than 3 years. And this is beneficial to the members of the public. I must say that there are cost overruns and delays with regard to projects. We cannot play a sufficient monitoring role if we proceed like this. Although I would support these projects, given the aging population, we need to have more hospitals and more improvement. For the four projects and the government architect, it is important because the architect is there to monitor the project, to make sure that everything is done well. cost overrun and delays, Under Secretary? Madam Chair, on the question of cost overruns, I don't think I can make available a lot of information, although I'm prepared to supplement after the meeting. For project delays, many times they're caused by specific issues like Kwong Wah Hospital Phase 1. When we excavate the foundation, there was subsidence and there was also anomalies associated with the underground water. And these were the unforeseen circumstances. In some cases, we received suggestion that we need to increase the plot ratio. We make the building bulk higher, and we have to go through the town planning board. And these were not anticipated at the beginning, but where possible, we will stick to the timetable. I've got no further question. Thank you. Dr. Helena Wong. Madam Chair, we also support the redevelopment of the hospitals. We are concerned that with the hardware, we may not have sufficient software. You may have additional 6,000 beds, but the government fails to reassure us that they will have enough manpower to man these facilities, the new beds and the new operating theatres. We cannot see any plan on the part of the government to increase the manpower. I am concerned that we're falling behind. So while they are expanding the hospitals, they should present a proposal regarding the manpower situation. Grantham Hospital, I go there for my ophthalmic eye consultation. I've stayed there. It is pretty dilapidated. I hope that this can be done as soon as possible. And there is no parking for the visitors, and people have to walk up, or they have to go up there by minibus. I hope that there would be parking spaces designated. After an eye operation, I mean, you can't see well enough, or you have to wear shades, and you have to be accompanied on your way out of the hospital. And there is a need for parking spaces. When you plan the hospitals, now, the same can be said about other hospitals. Princess Margaret Hospital, also the parking fees are really exorbitantly expensive. And I hope that in redeveloping, revamping these hospitals, you would provide enough parking spaces. Or you might also wish to provide family-friendly toilets. The carers can also accompany their patient family members into the toilet. In previous projects, you never mentioned the creation of a supernumerary post. For these projects, all of a sudden, you need to create a supernumerary post. After today, will you split up the different portion? Will you submit a separate paper on this supernumerary post to the PWSC and the FC? I am a little bit bewildered here that these supernumerary posts that will be there for 7 years, is it justified if the person is not doing a good job, we're stuck with him or her for 7 years, and there may be delays in the program? Are you hiring an architect, or are you hiring an engineer, or are you hiring a project manager to oversee all the different hospital projects? And also for the previous hospitals, Tin Wan, Queen Mary, Kwong Wah, will this project postholder be in charge of all these projects in his 7-year tenure? Under Secretary, in terms of hospital design and family-friendly features, toilets and so on, all these facilities. Are being looked at in the development of new hospitals or revamp of the existing hospitals. This is not the first post regarding the 10-year HAD. In 1617 onward, we do have the creation of post to handle the whole series of projects and the financial situation. We have three branches at the ASD, and they are looking at the HDP projects. The 10-year HDP covers a long time. We have the second HDP. The workload will be multiplying. This is indicated in the paper. 150 billion dollars will be on the way, and the second branch is in charge of this. If we get the funding approval, all the HDP projects will come under this supernumerary post. We have soft funding for a surveyor post, and the workload will be increasing tremendously. And this post holder will be in charge of all the HDP projects. Some of the questions remain unanswered. Perhaps prior to this being submitted to the PWSC, you would make available a reply. Mr. Prince Xuping, Madam Chair, I support the paper. My understanding is that you're creating a supernumerary post to deal with the 20-odd billion dollars worth of projects. And for these four projects, the Grantham Hospital redevelopment, and you're going to demolish the phase one, and in enclosure three, you mentioned that the senior staff quarters and nurse quarters will be demolished, and what arrangement would that be for the staff members there if they are demolished? The second one is the health center in Patmore Road. The Shetwehui Jockey Club Center is very dilapidated. Will this new center be replacing the Shetwehui Center, and what's going to happen to the existing center? The other project is the Supporting Services Center. The epidemic has highlighted the importance of a stock of the PPEs, and in the paper, you said that you have 3-day stock for key linen items and all the rest of the supplies. Now, with this Hospital Authority Supporting Services Center, what is the inventory like in terms of supplies and how to work out the supplies there? Before I call upon the administration, I have exercised my authority to extend the meeting to 1:30, and we'll end the meeting after this meeting. The last remaining item will be left over for the next meeting. Grantham Hospital and also the Supporting Services Center. This one I'll call upon my colleague to supplement. We are seeking member support for the creation of the supernumerary post. This post holder is not dealing with these four projects. He will be dealing with the 10-year hospital development plan. When the cash flow is at its height, and when the projects are in full swing, there will be a strong need for directorate support, and we're going to be embarking on the second 10-year HDP, and there is a need for us to create this particular post. At different stages, we have created non-directorate posts, and 2 years ago, we have created the quantity surveyor post, and they all of them have to do with the oversight of these projects. For the North District Health Center, the idea is to create a district health center. This is a enhanced version of the GOPC, and the She Wu Hui Center, by the time we have relocated the GOPC to the new location, it will reserve a certain space for decanting purposes if other centers have to be revamped. Now, Grantham Hospital and HA, my colleague, might wish to supplement. We turn up Dr. Smite, please. Hang on, the mic's not on. Yes, please. Dr. Mills, mic, please turn it up. Will you raise your hand? The world cannot spot you. All right, okay. In the course of work, like the senior staff quarters, the lease has come to an end by the middle part of last year. For the nurse quarters, we've been to Grantham Hospital. It is a vast area, and for the existing facilities like the hall and other vacant quarters, we have revamped them, refurbished them.
So during the demolition, some original facilities such as the nurse quarters and a canteen, they would be moved into the now almost refurbished buildings. Yes, it may be crowded for some time, but the facilities will still be there. Mr. Ray Chen? I support the four hospital expansion programs, and I hope that they can be submitted to the PWSC and FC as soon as possible. But there are long queues at these two committees, but if it's urgent, you can jump the queue. For example, today's FC meeting, an SME financing fund proposal jumped the queue. So do you want these to be done as soon as possible? Because these are not controversial projects. So do you think you can fight for a priority at these two meetings? And also, this paper involves the creation of a post. So we are talking about two queues. But are these two things related? That is, you need to create a post first before the projects can be carried out, or they are separate issues? I have another question. That's about the supporting services center. And it is said that during the epidemic outbreak, the HA hope that it can step up its work. It is hoped that a central storage can be set up so that they can cope with all sorts of emergencies. Well, for this epidemic, we've heard that the HA lacks a lot of supplies Well, some people are telling us that they are using disinfectants from the mainland, and after using the disinfectant, their hands are swollen, and there is also a shortage of masks, etc. So, what's the present situation? And you are saying that for the hospital clusters, they must keep an inventory which contains supplies of 90 days. So according to this epidemic's experience, for the central storage, will you raise the standards? Would you have a bigger storeroom so that more more items can be stored? Well, these are two questions. And one is about the HDP projects. The other is about the creation of a post. Now, for the hospital projects, because they benefit Hong Kong people, of course, we would like to ask the FC chairman to give us priority. As for the post, it's not only responsible for these four projects. For all the HDP projects, he would be responsible. He's also there to supervise and to manage the finance. So the creation of that post won't affect the progress of the four HDP projects, right? Well, there will be some influences. Otherwise, we would not ask the post to be created now. You don't have to wait for that person to take up the post before the work can be carried out, right? Well, you're right, but we don't want that to be delayed too much. I'll answer both Mr. Chen and Mr. Poon's question. For the central warehouse, well, our standard is 90 days. Well, but we would also look at this epidemic's experience. We will conduct reviews from time to time, and then we will try to decide on the suitable quantity. Earlier on, we've rented a warehouse off-site because we need to store more things. So for normal days, it's 90 days. But for epidemic days, is it still 90 days? We based on the swine flu experience, and then we come up with this figure. Mr. Sukachan, well, I'm a chronic patient, so of course I support this project. But the epidemic is changing the history, changing the world, changing Hong Kong, and changing HA, and it should also be changing the 10-year HDB. So now, with the epidemic, will there be any changes to this project? So the United Christian Hospitals, you are going to increase 560 beds. But for now, UCH has a pilot scheme. Some general wards are converted into isolation wards. And some experts say that this epidemic may last for 2 to 3 years. So for the HDB, would you be building more quarantine wards so as to cope with future epidemics? And my second question is about Princess Margaret Hospital. Now there is an infectious disease block there, but it's still not sufficient. Well, after the SARS outbreak, we were told that three infectious disease hospitals will be built, but now only one is built because the other two are said to be too close to residential areas. So will you continue to build more infectious disease blocks? Now for Central Hospital in Hong Kong, now is not being used. Would you convert it into such a hospital? Well, for the handling of infectious disease and quarantine beds, actually, do you want Dr. Young to answer the question? I just want to say one thing, that is about the long-term plan. We are talking about phase one, and for phase two of the 10-year plan, well, we will continue to consider the needs of quarantine beds. We have this first and second 10-year HDP. So when it comes to quarantine beds, when we decide on the quantity, we will always look at past experience. And the hospital you mentioned just now is included in our review process. Because we only have limited space, we hope that our wards can be converted for special purposes. Well, has the plague changed your plans? That is, other than your original plans, have you added anything? Because when you designed this plan, we didn't have the coronavirus infection. So now, will you be adding anything to them? Well, for these projects, the space of the hospitals is limited. So in the future, we will conduct reviews. Well, we will look at the hardwares and ventilation of certain wards and see if they can be convertible. So I think you should leave a room so that the general wards can be converted into special purpose wards. Mr. Charles Mock. Well, this is about hospitals, so we should all support it. So I went for lunch, but I was listening to the Under Secretary and I had a question, so that's why I come back. Now, for the HA Supporting Services Center at Lantau, well, it's great because you will have a data center there. However, in the same block, there is also a food manufacturing center, and also there is a laundry center. I've never heard that a data center can be juxtaposed with such facilities. Now, you need to look at security and the supply of electricity, because the a stable supply of electricity is very important for a data center. But if you want to wash clothes there, it also needs a lot of electricity. We do not want to see unstable electricity supply. It will only add to the difficulties of building that block. And when you use the washing machines, there will be shakings, and you do not want to put a data center there. I think this is far from ideal. Well, I don't know what is the exact design of the blocks and how many floors there will be and whether the data center will be at the upper floors, etc. But maybe everybody wants to fight for space at the lower floors. So before submitting this to the PWSC, please provide sufficient information to us. What's the design of the block? I've never heard of it. You want to put a laundrette together with a data center, and 50% of the capacity of the data center will be put here. I think it's even safer by sourcing out the servers. So these are all important facilities, but you shouldn't put them together. Think about the electricity supply and the physical vibration. Can you give us enough confidence? Can an advisor explain to us why this is possible? Please give us enough information. Otherwise, I'm very worried. Maybe my HR colleague can answer the question concerning design. Dr. Yang? Yes, we will pay attention to this and we will go back and take a look at the design. Yes, please look at the design and the allocation of the floors. Before you submit this proposal to the PwC, please provide the relevant information. So all members have asked their questions. Well, some members, before they left the conference room, they already said that they would support these proposals. Does anybody here object to these proposals? Okay, so these proposals will be submitted to the PwC and ESC. Thank you for attending the meeting.